an 8 original production.
Michael Crow here, Arizona State University. I'd like to welcome all of you to our public television station, KAAT, in downtown Phoenix. And we are a part of a national discussion today going on about at the same time at 75 different colleges and universities around the country. Three university presidents, including myself, David Scorton from Cornell University, and Eduardo Padron, the president of the Miami-Dade College in Miami, Florida, came together a few months ago and said we need to get the colleges to get a part of our role underway. We're the gatherers sometimes for discussions and debates. There's obviously a huge debate going on around the country related to immigration that's going on in Washington, going on in the state capitals, going on in various towns and cities around the entire country. And so here in Arizona, there's been a lot of discussion, a lot of debate about immigration, and so we thought, why not have a live public forum with some national leaders and some local leaders that we bring together to discuss immigration. Now, immigration is not just the issue of documented or undocumented immigration. It's a very large issue, and it's been a large issue in the United States for some time. In the history of the United States, if you look back economically, we have been very much an economy driven by the influx of new labor. We've been driven by a new labor that has come in skilled and unskilled and highly skilled across all of the various levels of initial capability. And it looks like going forward for our economy to be effective and efficient and in a sense successful going forward, that immigration is likely an ongoing and continuing factor for our success. Today what we're going to do is we're going to bring together different views. We're going to talk about immigration issues, be they the broad issue of immigration, that is attracting more students to the United States so that we can have as broad and as creative a workforce as we possibly can. And don't get me wrong, I support that very much. And a person that wrote in the Arizona Republic just recently said, well, what about all the American kids? Well, it doesn't mean in lieu of, it means in addition to. It means trying to take everybody up to the highest level of educational success possible and bringing in talent from the rest of the world to allow that talent to help drive our country forward. So today what we're hoping for is a focused and in the spirit of the university open discussion. At universities we discuss ideas. Those are usually backed by facts. They're probably less emotional at that particular point in the sense that it's about what are the facts, what are the options, what do we do, how do we move our country forward, and how do we continue on the path of both our social and economic success. Now, we've got a great panel here today, and to help our panel to be successful, we have one of ASU's newest scholars. You know him as Senator John Kyle, but he has left the Senate. He's left the Senate, yes. And he's working in Washington and doing a number of other things, but he's also hooked up with our College of Public Programs, our School of Public Affairs, and the Sandra Day O'Connor College of Law, helping our students and others to advance new ways of thinking and more advanced ways of thinking about all subjects. And so my own excitement for Senator Kyle being a part of our faculty is very high because he brings a level of intellectual rigor and academic foundation to all of the discussions of public policy that he's been involved in. And that is something that we need in our country. We need our discussions and our debates to be based on the fundamental foundations of our country's design. And so, Senator Kyle, thank you very much for being here, and you'll introduce the panel, and we'll get going.
Thank you very much, Dr. Crow, and thank you for inspiring this panel, not just here in Phoenix, Arizona, but really in numerous places around the country on a lot of different college campuses. And thank you to ASU, of course, for hosting the event. I will be the moderator today. We've talked to the panelists about the way we want to proceed. And primarily, our goal here is to both provide a background of knowledge about the issue and about pending legislation, and also to get you thinking about various issues that are obviously going to arise, and perhaps at the end we'll be able to cover some of the things that would impede or promote the prospects for legislation actually passing the Congress and being signed into law. We're going to start with exploring the issues of the legislation. in order for comprehensive immigration to pass Congress. And I do this for two reasons. First, we believe that the Senate bill that's been introduced now will be considered relatively quickly. And secondly, that it covers most of the issues that have been discussed throughout the years. But one of the questions will be, is anything missing from that? And we're going to start with a presumption. And the presumption is that the majority of members of Congress, as well as the American public, believes that it is time again to tackle the issue of comprehensive immigration reform. We're not going to have a debate here today about whether or not that subject should be raised. That debate has really already begun, and our purpose here today is to better understand how it can go forward. Our panelists, as you've seen from the material you have, come from diverse backgrounds, all very knowledgeable, and they all approach the subject in a very constructive way, albeit from some different angles. Let me ask each of the panelists in turn to identify themselves to you and what they do right now, starting with Glenn.
Thank you, Senator. Glenn Hammer, President and CEO of the Arizona Chamber of Commerce and Industry.
Lisa Magana, I'm a political scientist in the School of Transborder Studies at ASU.
Scott Smith, a mayor of the city of Mesa and vice president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors.
Danny Ortega, I am an attorney here in town and the immediate past chair of the National Council of La Raza.
I'm Tamar Jacoby. I'm president of Immigration Works USA. We're a national federation of small and medium-sized business owners who want to see reform.
And I'm Bill Montgomery. I'm the Maricopa County attorney.
As you can see, these are experts all in different phases of the issue, and we hope to bring their knowledge to bear on the subject. And I'm going to start with the first round of questioning designed to describe and to some extent to analyze the provisions of the bill that was just recently introduced in the United States Senate, since that will be the first specific manifestation of legislation that will be dealt with in Washington, D.C. And I'm going to start with Professor Magana, because you have studied, you have written about all of these issues, and my first question to you is, does this Senate bill touch all the bases? And in answering, could you describe at least the key components of the legislation for our audience who may not have had the opportunity to review it yet?
Well, let me first do an overview of the proposed policy. There's essentially five parts. The first is border security or border enforcement. It calls for more funding, more technologies, more surveillance, and more border patrol. There's also a section that provides for a sort of a trigger that before we start focusing on perhaps the servicing or the changing the status of these 11 million immigrants, we have a measure of apprehension in terms of how many people should be apprehended a year. And we'll get to that later. The second part of the policy, proposed policy, is a, as I mentioned, changing the status of approximately 11 million unauthorized immigrants. And essentially, you get a provisional status for about 10 years. You have to pay back taxes. You have to pay a fine. You have to have no criminal records. You have to prove that you've lived in the United States continuously for about, I think it's prior to 2011. And then you have your status change. And it's nothing more than a work permit, essentially. And then after 10 years, you can apply for what is legal permanent residence. And after 5 years, then you can apply for citizenship. So it's a pathway to citizenship, but it takes approximately about 15 years. The third part is essentially worker visas. They're mostly for high-skilled, meaning higher educated, make more money, and they open the cap essentially for more immigrants to come in. And then there's also a temporary work program similar to the Bracero program, I guess you could say. And this is a program in that essentially recruits workers on a temporary basis with the promise that they go home eventually when the job is done. Employers, and this is for both high-skilled as well as temporary visas. American employers first have to see whether or not there are Americans that can fill these jobs first, and then, in fact, advertise for these positions from other countries. And then the last part of this policy is an E-Verify or a sort of expansion of what we have now. And it's essentially a way of checking whether or not these immigrants can legally work in the United States. We're not so clear how this is going to play out yet, but there's talk of biometrics and, you know, doing some sort of measure of how you look. And then you'll be put into a large registry, your name and information, and then essentially employers can check right now, check the background on whether or not you can work in the country legally. I think that's
it. You got that all into even less than 3 minutes, and thank you. That was really a great summary. Just one quick follow-up, and there is there's a tail on this dog, but it's very important, especially in the state of Arizona, and that's the agricultural workers.
Correct.
And there would be a pathway for them actually to get to a legal status even more quickly.
Correct.
And I guess we can cover some more of that a little bit later too. Thank you. Excellent presentation. Next, I'm going to Daniel Ortega. Daniel is part of an Arizona group, and if I could ask you, Danny, to describe the Arizona group and how you came up with what you believe are the key elements for successful comprehensive immigration reform. Does the Senate bill meet the bill?
Well, first of all, the Real Arizona Coalition put together what is known now as SANE, S-A-N-E, which is an acronym for several pillars of what we believe to be the principles behind immigration reform. We didn't want to get into particulars. We wanted to basically deal with some principles. And, of course, we start with secure our borders, which is what the S is here. And clearly this plan has a very aggressive program for securing our borders. The A account for those who are undocumented, also in a very aggressive program to identify those who are here in the country without authorization and figuring a way to give them a path not only to legal residency but eventually to U.S. citizenship. On the U.S. citizenship, SANE did not take a position but allowed people to take their own positions on it. The third was necessary bureaucratic and visa reforms. That kind of combines the issues of, you know, more workers for the future, establishing a market-based immigration system, and making sure that, you know, we make ad hoc adjustments to the manner in which visas are distributed. So the whole idea that, and I don't know that we covered this in the introduction, that those who are currently in line or those who have approved petitions, and I think we can cover that later, mm-hmm. Professor, are going to go to the front of the line before those who are unauthorized get to adjust their status to permanent legal residence. And then, of course, engaging all levels of government, which is the E and SANE, which deals with, allowing employers to be able to know who is legally in this country and authorized to work, because a large part of what's involved here is the different levels of government being involved in making sure that authorized workers are taking jobs. So from the standpoint of the kinds of things that Professor Magaña talked about and the pillars of the Senate bill and the pillars of SANE, I think we're pretty close, though in some cases more to the left and more to the right.
But it covered most of the territory that you all were trying to cover.
Absolutely.
And since you two were very succinct, let me just do a quick follow-up. Everyone has always said that for the 11 million to apply for legal status and then green card, legal permanent residency and citizenship, they should, quote, get to the back of the line. What exactly does that mean? Mm-hmm. You point out the fact there's quite a line already. And this legislation, as I understand it, has provisions to accelerate that line that's in existence right now so that it can clear in time for the 11 million to be able to apply for the legal residence after 10 years.
Senator, what we're dealing with here is 4.5 million people throughout the world who've got approved petitions in the pipeline. And but for the fact that there aren't enough visas to allow them to immigrate, they're waiting. And what this Senate bill does is basically say you're going to be first. There are going to be an allotment of visas, which is a little bit complicated, but there's going to be an allotment of visas for those people first before the people who came in without authorization become permanent legal residents. Now, that doesn't mean that those people who are here without authorization aren't going to be able to register, as Professor Magaña said, and be able to be here legally and work here legally and travel legally. It just gives those the first opportunity. 4.5 million people is a lot of people.
Yeah, to clear for citizenship before the 11 million would be eligible to actually apply for that. I think it's important to clear that now. Tamar Jacoby has been involved in these issues in Washington, D.C. for a long time, I'll just put it that way, and has been a part of the negotiations that led to the drafting of the Senate bill in several key respects. So I'm going to ask her a little bit tougher question, maybe. What are some of the potential problems that are going to arise here? Where are we likely to see some friction? Where will some of the debates be occurring that will help to determine whether or not, A, the bill might be changed somewhat, and B, it will in fact end up getting passed?
Yeah, that's a terrific question. When you look at this bill, and as Lisa described it, I almost see it as a civics lesson in how to do bipartisan legislation. You know, we all think Washington is broken and they don't know how to negotiate anymore and they don't know how to agree. They don't know how to find those compromises. The Gang of Eight actually did a remarkable job here in finding the middle ground between the Democratic position and the Republican position. But they've come to the compromise. That doesn't mean everyone on the two sides of the spectrum and in the nation is going to accept their compromise. There's going to be people pulling them. You know, if they found the center sweet spot, there are going to be people all across the political spectrum trying to pull them off that sweet spot in the next few months as we debate this. So what are some of the directions people are going to be pulling, and what are some of those compromises? Well, the big compromise was, for Democrats, the most important thing is the answer for the 11 million people already here. Whereas for many Republicans, and these are obviously a little bit generalizations, but for many Republicans, the most important thing was securing the border so that we don't have another 11 million in 10 years or 15 years. So you had to have some kind of compromise between the people who said the most important thing is the legalization and the people who say, no, the most important thing is border security. And the compromise they came up with there is what Lisa described as these triggers, where the people with the 11 million will come out of the shadows and be able to work and be able to travel and not be afraid of going to their teacher's driving or going to their kids' PTA meeting, but they won't get citizenship until after probably 13 years, most of them. Some will get it a little earlier, but most of them, 13 years down the road, because we're waiting to see if the border's been secured. So that's sort of trade-off number one, but you will have people pulling. You'll have people who are for legalization who say, we don't want people to wait 13 years. And you'll have other people who want border control who will say, well, we're not sure the border's going to get controlled after that period. Then when we cut, so that's one big trade-off, one big division. Another big division is, you know, there's some people who say, well, these people should have citizenship. There are a lot of other people who say, well, do we really want to give away citizenship to people who have broken the law? Legal, we can't send them. Most people are coming around to the idea we can't deport them. A lot of people are coming around to the idea they're probably not going to go home by themselves. But there's still a division between the ones who want to say legal status is enough and the ones who want to say it should really go all the way to citizenship. And again, the Gang of Eight have found a pretty good sweet spot on that. But there's going to be people who are pulling in both directions. People are going to say it has to be a more obvious way to citizenship. There's several other employment. Should more visas be about employment? Should more visas be for because you have relatives here? They found a sweet spot on that. Business and labor issues. There are three new guest worker programs, or one new guest worker program and revisions to two others. Should businesses' concerns be more important or labor's? Lots of trade-offs. Lots of people are going to be trying to pull them off center. They've done a remarkable job. What we're going to see in the months ahead is, does anyone succeed in pulling them off center? And if they do, the bill probably, that's what will derail the bill.
That is more than a three-minute question. I mean, that's the ultimate question. How will these tugs and pulls affect the ultimate result? And we'll really explore that throughout the rest of the morning. One of the things that you alluded to was the agreement between labor and business through the Chamber of Commerce with respect to not just visa reform that President Crow spoke of. I mean, this is larger than the illegal immigrant problem. It is what to do with our whole system of immigration in the country, but also what's referred to as the future flow, the need for guest workers or temporary workers. And Glenn Hammer, being the chairman of the Arizona Chamber of Commerce, is very familiar with the work that was done by the business leaders in Washington, as is Tamar, on this compromise between the labor interests and the business interests in devising this new W visa for workers that might be needed for jobs here in the United States. And I found it interesting that it looks to me like about half of the bill is devoted to this very complicated system that was basically agreed to. And I wish you could describe for us, again in 3 minutes, how this came together, how it works, what the idea is, and what you think the challenges might be in this particular part of the immigration reform.
Thank you, Senator. And I want to first say that we wouldn't even be here if not for your fine work over the years to really tackle a lot of the issues related to immigration reform, and in particular, the border security issues. This is not the type of legislation that you could find a nice room in the Capitol, bring eight senators together, and get through in 3 weeks. So there's been a lot of groundwork done. And we're very fortunate in the state of Arizona that our two U.S. senators, Senators McCain and Flake, have gone all in to solve this issue. Tamar Jacoby of Immigration Works has done yeoman's work over the years in really working on some of the issues related to visa reform. And one of the sticking points of this bill, and one of the things that I think at the end of the day will determine whether or not it's successful, is this future flow issue. And in terms of how labor and business came together, I want to first say that the business community is strongly behind this Gang of Eight proposal. You have 125 groups and business leaders in the state of Arizona who have signed their name. Many are in the audience right now. In terms of the architecture, I think there's two issues. One, for the lower skilled, and you have to divide that up. On the ag side, there's almost universal agreement. We need to do something there. The system's a complete mess. Even in the toughest economy since the Great Depression, we didn't see Phoenix emptying out and moving to Yuma to take those jobs. And even some of our friends in the commentary community, like Bob Robb, who have written about this issue of future flow, you know, have acknowledged that on agriculture, we need to take care of that. I think that area is in pretty good shape. I think on the high-tech area, thanks to the work of Dr. Crow and some others, there's some very exciting things in the legislation. Probably the most difficult area will be in the non-ag lower skilled. And the two issues there are the architecture of the program, and let's make sure Tamar Jacoby continues to work on that. And we also need to work on the number. The numbers are probably, there needs to be a mechanism where they could be higher. And I say that because the original U.S. Chamber number, I believe, was 400,000. The bill starts at, I could be wrong, at 15, 20,000. It'll scale up potentially to 200,000, but there's a lot of bureaucratic mechanisms in there. Now, where did that 400,000 number come from? It basically, business looked at, what were the flows into this country of people entering illegally between more normal, prosperous years in this country? That number is probably going to need to go up. The program is going to need to be simplified, but it's a huge deal that labor and business have come together in support of this concept.
And these are for what kind of jobs?
These are for construction-type jobs. These could be restaurant-type jobs. And this notion that we don't need foreign labor for these types of jobs really isn't accurate. I'll give an example. On the construction side of things, you've got in Arizona, from David Jones, the Arizona Construction Association, the average age of a construction worker in the state of Arizona, I believe, is about 47. The average wage is about $44,000, a pretty good wage. Even in this economy, which is starting to come back, they're now finding it difficult to find enough workers. Imagine when our economy really starts firing on all cylinders, what the demand will be. And if we don't take care of that issue, we will be back where we were in 1986.
Great. Thanks. And I do want to get back to that because there is a specific limit on construction workers within the overall limit, as I understand it. Now, we've kind of been ignoring one big elephant in the room already, but fortunately we have our county attorney, Bill Montgomery, here to provide some good legal advice.
You're not calling me the elephant in the room.
No. We also have other attorneys on the panel here, but Bill is in charge of enforcing the law here, and he's been right in the middle of a lot of these enforcement issues, certainly a lot of the controversy around Senate Bill 1070, and enforcement is going to be a key question here. Will the law be enforced? Questions about the past laws, are they being adequately enforced? How will this law be enforced? How will we know it'll be enforced? What will the challenges be and all of that? Way more than 3 minutes, but Bill, could you at least discuss in an opening way some of the legal approaches here and some of the potential challenges for law enforcement side of this legislation?
Sure. Well, and there are really several different levels as well. Part of the E that Danny was alluding to in the SANE platform for engaging all levels of government noted that going forward, we're going to have a commitment to interior enforcement and that necessarily requires cooperation between local, state, and federal officials. A couple of areas within the Senate legislation, though, that I think does acknowledge that, though there may be room to underscore that point more as we go forward, is that there has to be increased prosecutions for unlawful border crossings in the Tucson sector. That was one of the major reasons why the Yuma sector was able to come under operational control, because they were prosecuting crossers instead of just returning them, what then was referred to sort of as catch and release, and then allowing people to self-deport afterwards. So increasing the number of prosecutions at the federal level for border crossers benefits local and state law enforcement, because we then don't have crimes associated with human smuggling occur in the interior. We've had shootouts here in the Phoenix area over the course of time between rival human smuggling gangs fighting over cargo. It's a very real issue for us. A couple of other important points in this legislation, too, is that it provides for increased funding above current levels for Operation Stone Garden, which is an ongoing grant program administered by the Department of Homeland Security that provides funding to local and state criminal justice agencies that are dealing with crime associated with illegal immigration and drug smuggling. So there'll be more funding there to help with that. There also is, I guess you could call it a reauthorization of the state criminal apprehension program, also called SCAP. And SCAP funding is something that's always been important in Arizona, because at the height of unlawful entries, where the numbers apprehended were in the hundreds of thousands, but so were the numbers of people getting into the interior, our jail population, our prison population reflected that in being paid then to detain individuals who got across the border because of the federal government's failure to secure it was a cost that we were bearing, and we sought reimbursement. That's in there too. There also, though, is another acknowledgement that for local and state officials and agencies that are going to detain unauthorized entries as part of that federal prosecution program, that there will be reimbursement for them as well. And I should also point out that there's a specific call out too for tribal law enforcement agencies. In the Tucson sector, the majority of that is overseen by the Tohono O'odham Reservation, which straddles both Mexico and the United States. So their participation and cooperation in this effort, recognized in that one aspect, is going to be important.
Yeah, thank you very much, Bill, for a real quick survey there. Now, you know that a job is tough when nobody wants to challenge the person that presently holds it. Mayor Smith was actually elected without opposition, which demonstrates that it must be a tough job.
And without acclamation either.
Yeah, right. So
I just sort of showed
here,
up.
Here, Mayor, you take it. We don't want it. But he has presided not only over the, what is Mesa now, the 38th largest city in the country. We tend to forget that, but also it will be the incoming chairman of all of the organization that represents all of the mayors in the whole United States. I think the first time in Arizona has held that position. So he's had a chance to visit with a lot of mayors around the country, and I wanted to get his perspective as somebody in local government, on the ground, knowledgeable about the employment issues, the law enforcement issues, and having talked to a lot of other colleagues around the country, your perspective on how well you think, well, what the challenge, does this legislation, I guess I'll be specific, begin to meet the challenges that you've seen in the way that you think is most desirable?
First of all, thank you once again to everyone for bringing this together. And am I the only one whose head is spinning and we haven't even really gotten into the details? And I think that's one of the challenges. Mayors have a unique perspective on immigration, as they do with most laws, and as Bill and others have talked about, because we get both ends. At the end of the day, the police forces that are being asked to enforce these laws, especially immigration, the political pressure and the real pressure is on local police departments. And yet we are struggling to take care of the normal challenges we have because of the financial struggles we have. So mayors feel like we're caught in the middle of a political battle. And at the end of the day, as you've seen this is being handled as a political question. Our concern on this end is that when we have quotas, when we have caps, when we have things that tend to basically ignore the realities, what I call human physics, the marketplace and human flow really doesn't care, as we've seen, as we've experienced, caps and limitations and even borders. They figure out a way to work around those. And at the end of the day, the responsibility for making some semblance of order that lies generally in our cities. So we experience the greatest challenge, because once you get past the border, then you're in the cities. On the other end, we're the ones that here are our business leaders and the owner of that company that wants to expand, who comes to us and says, Mayor, if I could only bring in this high-skilled person, and I cannot get through the visa system. So we're frustrated because we hit it on one side where it seems to be just we in reality are a dumping ground. And one of the challenges with 1070 is it was a bill that was heavy on enforcement, but most of the responsibility for enforcement fell on the cities and counties, and there wasn't a single penny allocated or appropriated to cover those costs. I'm glad to hear that there are provisions in the bill that recognize that. I have very little confidence that the check will ever show up. On the other hand, we're extremely frustrated but gratified that we seem to be changing the conversation to talk about the lost opportunities that we have because we have not fixed this mess. I think we absolutely need to secure the border. But the reason we need to secure the border is not to make sure we keep the wrong people out as much as it is to make sure that the right people get in. Because we see it in the cities that we are missing opportunities by our inability to bring in the right people that drive innovation, that drive our business. We see that on both sides. And so mayors are watching this very carefully. We're absolutely gratified with the Gang of Eight and the fact that we have a real proposal. We recognize it's a compromise. But right now the system is so broken on all sides that something needs to be done, and this is a great start.
Yeah, thank you for pointing out something else too. You see the two public officials here both focused on what this is going to cost and will the money be there. And I'll make an observation, and either of you correct me if you think I'm wrong or tomorrow. I think the bill, it specifies a lot of money, roughly about $5 billion, if I calculate it right, ultimately, for securing the border, and additional money for prosecution, the SCAP funding, the kind of thing the bill was talking about. So there is a recognition that it's going to cost money.
Now, Senator, can I bring up one thing?
Sure.
$5 billion for securing the border. Half the people, half the 11 million people who are here came into this country legally. They didn't walk across the border. They came to Disneyland and realized that this actually was the happiest place on earth. They stayed. And they're now in our cities. And what we're concerned with is that most of our enforcement relates to someone who has long passed the Border Patrol. They're now living and working in our cities. And a lot of those, and we have not given, when we talk about securing the border, we also have to come up with a system that takes care of people who enter legally and then who knowingly overstay their visas and then become part of that shadow group along with those who traipsed across the desert. And I don't think the bill has enough recognition that in the interior, that is a huge challenge to cities and counties.
We might ask Tamar about the entry-exit enforcement part of this, whether there are adequate resources. At least the problem is recognized. Whether there are adequate resources put against it might be a legitimate question, and the same thing for the cost to be verified, which I'm not sure has been identified. The point I was going to make is that the sponsors of this bill believe that it can be revenue neutral, but that is to say that the fees, and I guess that's the primary way of funding it, would make up for the funding. I'm skeptical of that personally, but in any event, that scoring has not yet been accomplished by the Congressional Budget Office, and that will be one of the issues that Congress will have to grapple with down the road, not to put an editorial point on it, but Congress is consumed with the cost of things these days, believe it or not, and so that will be an element that will have to be addressed. What I've concluded just sitting up here when the mayor said his head was spinning is we haven't taken enough time to describe the way the bill is intended to work together with the five or six different parts, as Professor Magana pointed out. And I'm going to get into that a little bit more with kind of a whole another round to try to flesh all of that out a little bit. But maybe as a way of potentially getting into that, let me play devil's advocate with a couple of our panels here. I can start with Glenn Hammer because he actually worked with me at one time, so I'm going to pick on him. He mentioned Bob Robb's name. Bob is a columnist locally here who loves to take jabs at just about everybody I've seen. And I told Glenn I was going to ask him the question, but here's what Bob recently wrote about the chamber's advocacy for more visas for low-skilled workers, since that's such a big part of this piece of legislation. He said, It's all based on a false premise perpetuated by the business community that the country has an ongoing need for large numbers of low-skilled imported workers. And that, in turn, is based on the false premise that illegal immigrants are doing work that legal workers won't. Except for in agriculture, that's not true. And then he backs up his argument with a reference to Pew Research Hispanic Center statistics, noting, for example, that illegal immigrants represent about a quarter of maids, housekeepers, dishwashers, and cooks, a higher percentage in construction work. So the question, isn't our stagnant wage situation for these jobs an indication of a surplus of labor, not a shortage, and why should national policy perpetuate this? Glenn.
Well, Bob Robb is one of my favorite columnists when he's not lighting me up like a Christmas tree. But as I was trying to get to, if we just go back to the construction trades, I believe that the way the bill is designed, it would, for construction, allow for 15,000 visas, W visas, for a total. Right now, the total employment pool in the construction area is about 6 million people. In these types of jobs, we wish that there were a surplus of workers. You know, one of the things that's amazed me since being CEO of the Chamber of Commerce is that in the toughest economy since our Great Depression, you go around our board table, and it's a big board table, we've got 100 board members, during the teeth of the recession, there was not one industry that said they had an adequate number of skilled and qualified workers. And there's a lot of components to that problem. But on the in the skilled construction area, you talk to the home builders in this state, you talk to certainly the people in the construction industry, there simply are not enough people who will do the jobs. You talk to roofers, for whatever reason, there just are not enough native-born Americans who will do those jobs. And I believe the way these programs are set up is that you cannot go to the Visa International Foreign Talent Pool until you make reasonable efforts to secure American citizens for those positions.
So you'll have to advertise publicly for the work, and then when not enough people show up, then you can go through the government agency for this work pool. And wages, there are requirements for certain wages, or how will that work?
Yeah, and there are requirements for those, that those wages, I believe that and Tamara would be probably a better person to answer the specifics.
In this less skilled worker program, you have to pay people what you're actually paying the same American working next to them, or a slightly higher wage that comes from the government, what's called a prevailing wage.
But I could think of a roofer that's a friend of mine. This is a Republican roofer who, we'll call him Ralph the Republican Roofer.
Republican roofer. Do they roof differently?
Or he's the owner
of
the roofing.
He does only red roofs.
He only does red roofs.
And only the right
he
side.
He has a problem of getting people to get on top of those roofs. And you think about the entire, you know, some of the Arizona economists have talked about gaps in our labor force. If he cannot find adequate labor, his business goes out. So I would argue that the international people who are coming over are helping to create American jobs.
So to some extent, the proof will be in the pudding. If the need can be demonstrated, then there is an opportunity. Your point is that there may not be enough visas available, even if it's proved.
Senator, just real quickly, I know we're going. You know, we talk about these numbers and everything, but I'd like to use a personal anecdote. When I graduated from high school now many years ago, we had most of my friends either went on to college or a lot of them went into the trades. I have many, many friends who became carpenters, concrete workers, plumbers. They ended up starting their own company, and they had a great lifestyle as that. My son, who is now 34, grew up in a very similar neighborhood to what I grew up in, went to a similar high school as what I went in. I asked him one day, how many of your friends went into construction trade? How many? He found one person who went to ASU to the School of Construction Management. He took the management route. Not a single one of his friends went into the trades. I asked my other son, who's now 31, how many of your friends went into the trades? Not a single one went into the trades. So, you know, when we talk about this, I think everybody has this same anecdote where you look around and it's a generational thing, it's a cultural thing. It's just not seen as a career path like it was as recently just a few short years ago is when I graduated from high school.
Let me turn to a different area to try to flesh out. It was the very first one mentioned when Professor Magana described the five key elements here. The first one, I think correctly, was portrayed as this tension between getting the border secured and then taking the next steps of dealing with the 11 million people and so on. And Professor, you've looked at this issue of metrics, how you measure securing the border. Could you describe and comment from your own point of view, but describe exactly how this is supposed to work in terms of what has to happen first, what has to happen second? Is it really a trigger, or is it more goals that one way or another should be met but not necessarily will? Describe how all of that will actually work in practice.
Sure. There's a lot of problems, I'll say right off, with this enforcement part, because you made such a great point. What do we mean when we say securing the border? You know, is it physical? We know, first of all, that we can't put a big triple-layer wall across all of Arizona. We couldn't do that because it's not completely flat. It's physically, environmentally impossible, and it's a lot of money. Secondly, this particular policy doesn't address, as you mentioned, visa overstayers. And how is securing the border going to fix this issue of people that come in legally, not illegally, through the desert? Third, it focuses on apprehension data, which is terrible. And the reason why, apprehension data is not a good indication of effective immigration policy. For example, and I've talked to numerous Border Patrol agents and people that from Homeland Security, and they'll say the same thing. Apprehension data could be, we apprehended 30,000 people, great job. The next year, apprehension data could be seen as an ineffectively carrying out immigration policy, and that 30,000 people were able to circumvent enforcement. So, I mean, using these data as a way to assess good immigration policy is not such a great idea. And people can be apprehended more than one time, right? And the other thing that I'm concerned about is this idea of so much money being put towards making the border more dangerous, and we know more secure. And the idea is that the tougher we make it for people to come to not come in, we know that it makes it way more dangerous. We know that the death toll has gone up as border enforcement has become much tighter. And we can disagree on the motivation why people come in and that they're breaking the law, but there absolutely is a human element that is not considered in this. And so you asked about what this policy intends to do. It's going to measure, it's not going to carry out the social aspect or the legalizing part until we have secured the border. We can prove that we have a plan to secure the border. And it's based on this apprehension data. So for example, one particular sector, for example, Yuma, say 30,000 people come in or were apprehended that year. This plan proposes that the Border Patrol in that Yuma sector has to at least apprehend 90% or turn back 90% of that 30,000 in a given year. That's going to be proof of an effective immigration policy. The other part that's problematic, and again, numerous conversations that I've had with Border Patrol, is that they say that the apprehensions have gone down. They're aware of this, but not because of what they're doing, not because there's more Border Patrol, because the economy has tanked. And so I don't see a lot of this enforcement money significantly having that much of an impact. But people like to believe it. People like to say we need to secure the border. And I ask you all for something to think about is, what does that mean to secure the border? Particularly, again, with 40% are visa overstayers.
So first, understand that 40%, I think the figure is widely agreed on, of the people who are here undocumented came here with a visa to study, to be a tourist, or there are a few others, and then they stayed beyond the term of the visa, and they are illegally in the country as a result, but they didn't cross the border illegally. Mm-hmm. But the remainder were the people who came primarily across our southern border illegally. So the way the bill works, let's just flesh this out a bit, and maybe tomorrow, Bill, you could comment on it. The way the bill works is to have this measure, as Professor Magana pointed out, of the degree of successful apprehensions. And the first thing that has to happen is before anybody can even apply for anything, there has to be a plan submitted to as to how this is going to be accomplished. Once that plan is submitted, then the process for the regularization of everyone begins. And then there's a period of time for that plan to be effectuated. What happens if the plan's goals are not met? Would somebody like to describe that?
I'm sure. The three goals are this border measure that Professor Magana talked about, also that all the employers in the U.S. are using the E-Verify system at that point, the electronic E-Verify mm-hmm. system, and also that we have a system in place meant to identify the overstayers, where when you leave the country, it will be known. So everyone who's visiting, when they leave, it will on an airplane or on a boat, the government will know about it. So I don't know how much money it puts to find the people who haven't left, but at least 10 years from now, we'll know who hasn't left, how many overstayers there mm-hmm. still are. Those three things have to go in effect. If by five, and there's 10 years for all that to happen, if by 5 years it doesn't look like we're on track, we're going to create a border commission that right. will include the governor of this state and others, and they'll probably throw some more money at the problem, and this commission will come up with some other ideas about how we can get to more security at the 10-year point.
Yeah, I think they actually have another authorization of $1 billion or maybe more to try to effectuate whatever plan they might come up with. But meanwhile, does the process proceed for those who have been given legal status, the work visa status, that you described?
Well, nothing has to happen to them in those 10 years. In those 10 years, they're working, they're keeping their nose clean, they're paying their taxes.
And at the end of that time, can they apply for the legal permanent residency, which is the precursor to citizenship, whether or not these goals have been achieved?
No. And the key here is that, first of all, that provisional status that you have when you register only lasts for 6 years, and then you have to apply again. So technically, let's say you could fall into 12 years. Look at the 10-year mark. At the 10-year mark, the triggers are, we're just not securing the border. Therefore, those people who are these provisional registrants cannot become permanent legal residents until somebody says the border is secure. So folks who register and become these provisional immigrants, we won't know when they will become permanent legal residents.
Bill?
Well, and we've talked about a couple of things right now that highlight that the border security provision and the metrics there, I think, is one of the areas that will require further discussion. Yeah. And then I expect as it goes through the process to be fleshed out even more. Because the metrics themselves only focus on one of the three reasons why we need to have border security or effective control, as the legislation defines it. And that is to reduce the number of people crossing without lawful authority. But incorporated in that is also the national security reason, to cut down on the availability from special interest aliens or those from countries that we have a particular focus for because of their involvement in terrorism, and the transnational criminal threat with drug trafficking organizations. If we do these things, we necessarily will address those other two reasons, which I think are more compelling. So for us to get into a discussion over, well, if we could just engage in the visa reforms and the immigration reform, we wouldn't have that cross-border traffic. That's just part of it. We still need to do this in order to protect our national security and in order to deal with those criminal threats. Statistics are great. They don't always provide answers, but they can help show us where we need to go. In 2010, 58% of the heroin was seized along the southwest border. From 2010 to 2011, there was a greater than 1,000% increase in HIDTA seizures of heroin in the United States. Increase in seizures of heroin. Over the previous year. And fiscal year 2012, the number of seizures of heroin along the southwest border amounted to 93% of all heroin seized along the borders of the United States. That drug threat is continuing. And whether or not drug cartels and transnational criminal organizations are exploiting the border for human trafficking or drug trafficking, we need to do it. If we also look at incorporating drug seizures and countries of origin of those individuals who are apprehended at the border as additional metrics, I think we'll start to develop a better picture about the kind of border plan that needs to be developed. There are some really good aspects of the border control part of the legislation, including adding 3,500 Border Patrol agents and moving forward operating bases closer to the border and then enhancing those that are currently in existence. If you do that, and if they also follow through on deploying mobile surveillance systems, unmanned surveillance systems, drones, as well as additional helicopters and fixed-wing assets, we will have a better way of determining just how many people are crossing. Because there are entire sections of the border right now where there are no eyes on. And depending upon when someone's crossing and what kind of intel the cartels have developed, they can circumvent the systems that we have in place right now. If we improve surveillance, we should have better numbers of those who are crossing, which then means we should be able to apprehend more, which then means we should also be able to cut off the drug routes, which means we also should then be able to deny those who wish our country the worst from being able to take advantage of them too. All of that as part of this effort then supports denying people opportunities to circumvent the immigration system that we put in place. That's why we need to look at all of these areas at the same time.
And Bill brings up a good point about the balance, because right now it's a numbers game. And if we're using limited resources and they're focused on people who are not, I learned something new, special interest aliens. That's a new term I learned today. But if you look at that, we're focusing limited resources on a broad spectrum of people coming across. If you take the people who aren't a national security threat, who aren't in the drug trade, and provide a system where they can go back and forth on the border that somehow allows them to go over the right way, then we can focus on resources on those people who don't want to go over the right way. And I think so the national security as part of the securing the border is an important thing. But as Bill said, you've got to balance it with the fact that you want to give those people who are otherwise not involved in nefarious activities other than crossing the border a way to funnel to the points where you can control them so you can concentrate on the others.
And by the way, there are a lot of new customs agents also authorized in the legislation, which will help to lessen the lines, enhance trade, all of those things which we're not going to talk about today, but are, I think, positive elements of the legislation, recognizing the amount of commerce that we have, especially with Mexico, and the need to make improvements in that as well. But that's a subject for another day. Glenn, you had something
else to add. Just a quick point, and that's why it's so important to get, there's two other elements of the bill that are so important so that we can meet those requirements by that 10-year mark, and that's getting the W visa right so that the pressure is not on people to enter the country illegally, but to have good, hardworking, skilled people enter through a legal process. So tomorrow, it's very important we continue to work on that, as well as a point that Bob Robb made. We could expedite the full implementation of E-Verify. Arizona law requires every employer in the state to use E-Verify. For a federal program, it works fairly well. We could get that scaled up for every employer in the United States before the 4 or 5 year deadline in the bill. And I think that would be a disincentive for people to enter the country illegally.
Okay. And the chamber didn't always support the E-Verify, did it?
We lost at the U.S. Supreme Court, so no, we did not.
It's amazing how losing caused you to support
some
things.
Yeah. Well, we all adjust. I don't. Tomorrow, let me just ask you one question, because it is unclear to me that the failure to achieve the goals represents a bar in an individual being able to proceed to the process of citizenship. Is that your understanding of the way the legislation
works? My understanding
works?
Is that if we haven't achieved the goals, people will be...
It'll be an absolute bar.
Well, no. I don't exactly... Danny might know.
A delay. It's a continued delay. If we don't secure that border according to the metrics or whatever is put up as the bottom line, people cannot become permanent legal residents. So they'll remain as provisional immigrants.
We'll have to.
Senator, I don't think it's even that clear yet.
I agree with you. It's
so
unclear to me.
I'm not sure
either. Yeah. That is one area that will be. In fact, this is a perfect segue into the next. I was going to talk about trade-offs, and first of all, it illustrates the complexity here and the fact that, at least I confess, I haven't actually read the bill. I've read summaries of the bill, and perhaps that's part of our problem, Professor. I agree with you. It's not. At least to me, it's not clear yet.
Yeah.
This has to be cleared up, it has to be dealt with, and it'll be one of the great trade-offs.
If you read it, it's a lot of series of recommendations.
Yeah.
And I don't know,
A lot of money thrown
right.
at it. So, to the question of trade-offs, because this will help, I think, to flesh out also our understanding of the provisions of this bill and the kinds of compromises that were developed. I was actually going to quote something that Tamar Jacoby wrote. I thought she put it very well, but you said it earlier, namely, this is kind of a civics lesson. And here, let me just give a little pitch for my colleagues, the people that I used to serve with. You have four Democrats and four Republicans in the Senate, some conservatives, some liberals, some people in between, all of whom I think had the goodwill, the desire to try to constructively reach a solution that could be enacted into law to a difficult problem. That doesn't always happen in Washington, D.C., and so I think you can say that the people who tried to find this sweet spot were really coming at it from different perspectives, but trying to find the point at which they could agree, and perhaps they represented their colleagues broadly enough that that could then represent an agreement. But to do that required trade-offs on the part of everybody. And one of the two goals that I had for this discussion today, the first goal was to try to get a better understanding of actually how this legislative proposal would work and whether there's anything missing, and we still need to get to that question. But the second thing was to evaluate the kinds of trade-offs that have been made here, because each of us, if we could write the bill, would write a perfect bill, wouldn't we? But I suspect that it wouldn't, not all of our bills would look exactly the same. So that's the point of political compromise. And I know as a senator, people frequently came up to me and said, just sit down and work it out. Okay, here are eight people who tried to do that, but they had to make compromises. What are some of the trade-offs that have occurred that would help to point us to the way that this debate is going to unfold in the future, that we'll see people on both sides kind of disagreeing because there was a compromise involved? What are some of the key ones tomorrow?
Well, Senator, before we even talk about these compromises, I think we do need to give you some credit. You were this is the first time we're seeing compromises on this issue since you last compromised with Senator Kennedy. And I don't know how many other issues you and Senator Kennedy worked on, but
you didn't need to bring that up.
These eight are working in the tradition that you paved of really trying to find the sweet spot that a lot of other people have forgotten how to do that in the years since. But I wanted to dig a little bit into the one trade-off that I have been the closest to so far, which is this trade-off between people like Bob Robb, who say we really don't need these workers, and people like many of us on the podium who are saying we do need these workers, not just for businesses here, but because that's the only way we're going to channel what's now an unauthorized flow into legal channels. If we don't have enough legal ways for these people to come to work, the demand for the jobs, nature's going to find a way and they're going to try to get here. So those are both very legitimate concerns, right? I don't think anyone on this panel or anyone crafting the bill wants to depress U.S. wages or take jobs from Americans, but there's this other imperative, but we need enough construction workers, and if we're going to have construction projects humming here in Arizona, we want people to come legally rather than illegally. And that was, I think people will say that's been the hardest negotiation around this bill, was to find kind of that sweet spot. And some of the things that are traditionally hard in business labor negotiations, we figured out pretty quickly, like the wages. We figured out an answer to that, and the steps that the employers have to take to try to find an American first, they figured out the answers to that. Certain steps that employers have to try and find Americans. We even agreed on some trickier things. One of the things the unions say is that as long as if a worker comes and he can only work for one employer, he doesn't really have any labor rights because if he can't quit, he can't really negotiate with the employer. Business said, you're right about that. We don't actually need to sponsor an employee and keep him for the whole time he's here. We're okay if he comes and works for me, and if he doesn't like me, he can quit and go to work for another employer who's tried to find an American. So, tricky trade-off where business and labor realized actually they kind of had the same interests there. Similarly, with Professor Magana was talking about at the end of the program, people would go home. Actually, this is a break the mold temporary worker program, because if at the end of your 6 years you actually have done well in America, you can petition to get on to stay permanently, to get a green card and stay permanently. So business and labor worked out a lot of really hard things. The one piece I think we didn't really work out adequately was the size. Labor wanted a relatively small program, and as Glenn was laying out, business wanted a much bigger program. And I think that's not just because business wants cheap labor, it's because we have this concept of if this program isn't big enough, there will be a continued unauthorized flow. And I think that's still a place where, there needs to be some adjustment, but I think everyone's aware, I go back to my circle metaphor, if you pull it too far away from the center of the circle, it can't pass, because if labor's really too unhappy, they're not going to support it, and a lot of Democrats won't support it. So, you know, there's this pressure to stay in that center of the circle no matter what you think the right answer is.
And interestingly enough, one of the things that killed the legislation in 2007 was this same debate about the number of lower-skilled temporary visas. So these are serious issues that divide people, and there are good arguments on both sides, and it's a matter of tension, and it's one of the areas that will have to be fought out. One thing that Dr. Crow emphasized, and I don't think we've talked quite enough about, and let me ask Professor, ask you, because I know you know something about this, and Danny, I know we've talked about it too. That's the other side of the visa reform, the higher skilled visas. This legislation actually reforms our immigration system with some important trade-offs. Let me see if I can describe it accurately. You all tell me if you think I'm wrong. It adds some visas, but not all of the new high-skilled visas are a result of addition. Some are substituted for a couple of existing categories. There are currently 50,000 so-called lottery visas. You want to come to the United States, throw your name in the hat, and if you're one of the lucky 50,000, you get to come. My understanding is that that category has been eliminated and transferred for these higher-skilled categories. Secondly, the United States has been one of the countries that predominantly focused on family reunification or family visas. If you're a relative, it's a lot easier to come into the country. Some of those visas are being phased down or phased out. It wouldn't be as easy to bring in a brother or a sister or somebody who is a more distant relative than that. And those visas, that capacity then is also applied to the higher tech visas. Now, these are trade-offs. What do you think about those trade-offs?
I think that that was great summary. The other part is that there will be provisions for student visas with post, if I'm correct, postgraduate visas. So people beyond getting a master's or PhD make it a lot easier for them. And
flesh that out a little bit. I think that's really okay. Dr. Crow would want us to flesh that out.
Okay. He referred
to his studio, so we better do that.
Yeah. STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. And so people with postgraduate degrees would be receiving it much easier to apply for visas. There'll be provisions set, numbers set for them to
wouldn't
enter.
Have to have an employer apply for you.
Right.
You could self-petition.
Absolutely. And the other part that there are still provisions, though, for family sponsorship in these visas, in all of them,
yeah.
Particularly those that are legalizing and those that are on a temporary basis, as you mentioned. I'm glad you brought that up. For the temporary worker, it definitely narrows it down. So I would say, overall, it's more based on skill, more so than family preference. And that is a big change.
Well, to put that in a little bit of perspective, right, so currently 85% of the visas we give out are given for reasons other than employment. Mm-hmm. Family gets about more than two-thirds, and refugees get a lot, and other people. Most countries in the world, it's a much bigger percentage for workers they need. Right now, we give out 15% for workers, but that includes their spouses. So really, only 7% of the green cards we're giving out every year are going to workers. This bill is going to move that balance a little bit, but it's not even moving it to the middle. We're still going to have a basically family-based system.
There would still be more than 50% of the visas that would be family-based, as I understand it, right?
But if I could, I mean, you know, and I would like to expand.
And then, by the way, we're going to come to the audience right next.
Yeah, so. If I could expand on one of the words. This high end is not about workers, and I think that's what we're missing. This is not about workers. These are about producers. These are about people who start companies and who invent things. One thing we've lost in this whole deal is we've pushed out the people who come to our country and who historically have started companies. And there was, I think, last year or the year before, over half the patents issued in the United States were to foreign-born people. Mm-hmm. We've shut these people out. The founders in Silicon Valley of companies that have gone public, well over half, one or more of the founders is led by a foreign-born person who has come in here and who has excelled and who has produced and created growth in a healthy economy, and we've shut these people out.
This is one area that is pretty universally accepted, isn't it? The numbers may not be accepted, but pretty much everybody agrees we need to address the
problem. Last year, for example, Canada is smaller than the state of California population-wise, issued more high-skilled STEM visas than the entire United States. That's a problem.
And then we're going to go to the audience right now.
And I would argue, I think one of the former heads of OMB estimated we get immigration reform done right, it could help reduce the national debt by $2.5 trillion, could raise per capita income by $1,500. One of the greatest things the United States has going for it is that the best and the brightest and the hardest workers from all around the world want to come here. And to not take full advantage of that is, in my opinion, economically criminal. And particularly when a lot of those people filter through our outstanding academic institutions such as ASU.
Now, I think the process is that people are supposed to come to the microphone so that everyone can hear the questions. And if you would please do that, we have about 23 minutes or so, and we'd like to devote that to your comments or questions. In the spirit of the discussion that you've heard here, again, rather than debating whether, if you could help to flesh out the ideas about how best to do it, given the fact that that's the debate the Senate's going to engage in, I would certainly appreciate that. Who's just please step up to the microphone and let's proceed. And if you have a question for a particular panelist, that would be fine, or if you just want to ask it generally.
This could be a question for everyone, but particularly the Attorney General. Regarding border
I don't want Tom Horn to get concerned.
That's right.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Well, if Tom's here, he can answer it as well. With regard to border security and the amount of money we're spending on border security, we continue to ignore the demand for drugs. Wouldn't it be more effective to, and this could be for all the panelists, to spend more money on the addiction problem in the United States, create jobs to stop the addiction, so that way we wouldn't have to worry about the demand? And working on addiction, you could create jobs at the city level, at the local level, county and city level, create really good jobs that you cannot send to other countries, and there'd be good paying white collar jobs with educated people. Would be what that seems would be more effective than the billions of dollars we're going to continue to throw at the border, particularly important, at, say, visa overseers.
Important question. I know, Bill, you've thought a lot about these things.
Sure, and thank you for the comment, because it also gives me the opportunity to say that these aren't either or propositions. They're both and. We should still secure the border and continue what we have been doing, particularly in Maricopa County, but throughout Arizona, and I'm sure many other jurisdictions, in focusing on substance abuse treatment. We've actually been very successful in taking people who previously would have gone to prison for possession or use offenses. They don't do that anymore, and providing them treatment. Our local substance abuse treatment program is actually over 80% effective in reducing recidivism for drug-related offenses. So we're doing that. But that's only one of the three reasons to secure the border. We still have the national security imperative and the imperative to not allow people to circumvent whatever immigration system we put in place.
Right.
If the grand strategy should not work, is there any chance that some of the most popular features, say the work visa, could still pass?
Great question.
Well, you know, the whole idea from the U.S. House of Representatives is to take this on a piecemeal basis. And so part of the movement, it seems to me, if something doesn't happen, that there will be something done in terms of STEM, in terms of agricultural workers, the piecemeal approach. So my hope is that the grand scheme does work, because this system is broken. And it has to be completely fixed, not just partially fixed.
Let me get one or two other comments.
Yeah, I think that is kind of plan B.
Yeah.
I think right now there's a lot of momentum around doing it all together. But should it come a cropper, I think plan B is piecemeal. The problem is those little things alone don't necessarily have enough votes. Even the high skill piece, there will be Democrats who will say, well, I don't want to vote for a loan because we're leaving other things out. And legal, there'll be people, even enforcement, people will say, well, it's hard to vote against enforcement, so probably enforcement will pass, but it's pretty hard to get enough votes for those other pieces unless you have a little something for everyone.
But if I could just interject here from a little bit of experience, it is very hard to do it one piece at a time. The so-called DREAM Act, or it's in its different iterations, was something that most people in one way or another agreed with. But as soon as you put out something that has pretty strong support, those who support elements that aren't quite as strong want to attach it so that their piece can then move too. And before you know it, everybody has tried to attach their piece to it so that it's no longer one or two. Mm-hmm. It's comprehensive again, and it has been tried. I think it will be very difficult to address this problem, the problem of immigration reform, without probably attaching a lot of different things together to have a critical mass. But That's just my prognostication. It'd be pretty hard to do it if it's not comprehensive.
And the problem is that if we don't do a comprehensive, we don't do the whole thing, we've proven that we can meddle along with a really bad system. And as Glenn said, it's damaging us. It's killing us economically every day. It's killing us socially. It's killing us culturally. So this is really a high-stakes situation that we have to get right.
A lot of the efforts seem to be focused around interdiction after the event, after the illegal incursion occurs. Now, I'm a physician, and prevention is a lot of what I do. I simply cannot accept the proposition that a wall cannot be made. I'm a child of the generation that went to the moon. Surely, if we had a national will to do so, we could secure the border in a physical sense, not just a fence, I mean a wall.
If I could, let me say, I traveled to Saudi Arabia a couple of years ago, and we were meeting with the interiors, one of the crown princes, the interior secretary, and he said something that was fascinating, and it actually changed my view and approach. Saudi Arabia would never be confused as a totally open society. You can't go two blocks without, basically that. We asked the interior ministry, what is your number one domestic problem? Illegal immigration. Going, excuse me? Now, Saudi Arabia doesn't have a Mexico. It's got Yemen. It's got these other things. No country like a Mexico to filter things up. And he started explaining that, the fact of the matter is that human nature and the law of what I call human physics brings people to where opportunity is. And you can create the biggest police state you want, and you're going to still end up with a Saudi Arabia where the number one issue is still illegal immigration.
Could I just add?
We also had the Secure Fence Act, and they didn't finish it because, again, it was physically impossible. All of Arizona is not completely flat, and they said it's not it is impossible to create a fence. And, again, it'll just circumvent people to another spot.
Let's ask our law enforcement official here. Well,
yes. And real quickly, I've been down on the border several times, surveyed the area. I've seen where fencing is. It can work well. There are places such as Oregon Pipe National Monument where fencing wouldn't work, and it's from this very simple premise. When I was a young lieutenant in the Army, I was taught that when you're going to put up an obstacle, you've got to be able to have eyes on it, and you have to get to it in the event that someone is trying to get through it or over it or around it. Mm-hmm. If you can't do that, it's not an obstacle. It's a speed bump. If you try to put up literally a wall across the entire southern border, you will just create areas where later on, when you're able to get to it, you will find the holes. What we have to be able to do, though, now that's not an excuse to not secure that border, but where you can't put a physical barrier, you must have the other sensors, the other surveillance assets on hand to be able to detect when someone does cross and then be able to interdict at the first possible opportunity. That can be done. But a fence every linear foot, it can't.
Let me close this off with Tamara, and then we'll go to the next comment.
The questioner has exactly the right question, though. How do we prevent? And the answer is the best prevention is going to be a legal immigration system that works. That's going to be the best antidote to illegal immigration. 99.999% of the people of the 11 million who are here now illegally would rather have come legally. You don't get anything out of coming illegally, but we had no system for them. So the way to prevent this in the future is a legal way for people to get here so that human physics doesn't take over. And
one other thing is that the one thing to stop illegal immigration, they said, is 3% unemployment here in the U.S., a strong economy. We've seen that when our economy went down, but what we forget, and in Arizona we should be especially sensitive to this, is the Mexican economy has been booming. And if we get a strong Mexican economy, people can stay home. They don't have to come here for opportunity. And we don't enter that into the negotiation. I'd rather, if we were going to spend resources propping up something, I'd want to help improve an economy which kept people at home rather than building barriers that keep people out for the wrong reason.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm a member of the Arizona Hispanic Community Forum and also belong to several other Latino organizations. One of our greatest concerns is separation of families, and especially due to the raids that have been caused by SB 1070, the enforcement of that. And while we totally support criminalizing people who do drugs and belong to cartels and all of that, we feel that the crime committed by them is different from the raids that picked up people who were working with an invalid Social Security card to put food on the table for their families. And so in determining who is eligible to even apply for permanent residency, we'd really like to see that they would weigh those two differently, the criminals that are involved with drugs and cartels versus someone, a single mother or a father who's just trying to put food on the table for their families. And we would like to know if Real Arizona or anyone else is willing to lobby Washington to change that and make it an exception.
But that raises a very good question, because you've all heard the sort of trite phrase that the application to become a legal resident, and before that to have legal work status here, depends on you paying a fine, paying your taxes, and not having a criminal background. Question: what is a criminal background? For purposes of this legislation and the ability to apply for the work and 6-year visa and then later legal permanent residence and citizenship, would somebody on the panel like to address that question?
I would.
Sure, Professor.
You're the attorney.
At least 30 seconds, because I got to clear it up. Worksite raids have to deal with identity theft, which was not part of SB 1070. So those enforcement actions have absolutely nothing to do with 1070. It was part of our identity theft statute, which was passed back in 2008. So the two are not associated. And as far as distinguishing between the different types of offenses, how that gets done within this immigration bill, now, there's room to discuss that too, because right now you're restricted from participating in the process if you've been convicted of a felony. That would include criminal trespass of a residence, let alone anything else. So that's an area open then for discussion.
I think some of the things you're referring to is what's happened through the Maricopa Sheriff's Office. And this was 287G, which was a provision in a 1996 act that said you can stop a bad guy, and if he's a bad guy and you think he's an immigrant illegally in the country, then you can ask. Not a shocker, here in Maricopa County, we had crime suppression sweeps. We know woefully violated 287G. The Justice Department has come in and looking into these incidents where kids are separated from their parents when mom or dad goes to work. So there have been noted violations by the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office for these sort of actions.
To keep the record clear, though, there's allegations. It has not been proven, and it's unfair.
The Justice Department, actually, we have.
Well, no, those are allegations, and they filed suit, and they've yet to provide the discovery to prove that. So it's incorrect to assert that that's a fact.
But Homeland Security has taken money away. Money has been taken away, though, for violating 287G.
The question is, what kind of conduct would prohibit the 11 million people who would like to become regularized, would like to have a legal status, followed by legal permanent residency, and for those who wish, citizenship? What kind of conduct on their part would prohibit that under the legislation that's been introduced? I'll tell you what I think it is, and then you all correct me if I'm incorrect here. You would have had to been convicted of a felony to not be eligible. So that if you, for example, had worked illegally and perhaps had used a Social Security number or card that was not valid, but you were never prosecuted for that, that in and of itself would not be a bar to becoming legal under the bill. Am I correct?
Correct.
Correct.
Okay. So you'd actually have to have a criminal record for a fairly serious violation. The object here is not for the 11 million people to all be identified as having violated the law and therefore not eligible for the benefits of the legislation.
My advice on the question is this. There are clearly going to be some situations where there's employment fraud using a fake Social Security number that is going to prevent a family or a person from immigrating into this country on the basis of this bill. And my suggestion to you is that you continue to lobby your congressmen and your U.S. senators to get an exemption for that particular crime.
Yeah, I don't think, I think right now the legislation anticipates that kind of, quote, crime will not bar the application here.
Yeah, a conviction is what we're talking about. Most people have not been caught, but for the people that have been caught, we need to lobby for an exemption on that basis.
Yes, ma'am.
The previous person did bring up one thing that I was going to ask, but the behavior of Border Patrol and ICE towards immigrants is driving them underground. If a person can walk into an ICE office for paperwork to become legitimate and be grabbed and thrown into Eloy, which is a vacuum, which is an unspeakable, I won't even go there, how can these people move forward? And they're individuals with families, not anchor babies, but families that they've been here for 30 years or whatnot.
This is a practical question of how you get people who have some fear to step forward under a system under which we're now promising that you don't have to be afraid. But how does that, as a practical matter, happen?
I'm sorry, that's not true. Because if someone walked into
all I was doing was asking a question.
The
question is, how can we resolve
them.
This?
And let me tell you that a few years ago when we tried to do this, we were very mindful of the dilemma, the exact dilemma that you've portrayed here. And we tried to set up a situation in which that fear would not exist. There would be at least 1 year, and I think there were longer periods of time with which under which people would have the opportunity to step forward so that when it was early demonstrated that it did work, hopefully everybody would come out of the shadows and so on. But let me ask the panelists if
Can
they know.
Can I just finish my question? I apologize. I just want to finish
sure,
one thing.
Sure.
When we talk about all the money that we need to do all of this, $9 billion a year is being paid into the system through payroll deductions by immigrants who, if they can't become citizens, get deported, will never collect those benefits that they pay into. $9 billion per year out of payroll deductions that just go into that.
Right. Okay, now the question again was, is it practical to think that folks really will be willing to step forward in order to regularize their status? And what does the legislation do to deal with that?
We have a good case study, a good record that this can work. In 1986, when we had IRCA, and this is the INS when the agency was all under one umbrella, that people were, they did a great campaign and outreach telling people it was safe. You could go in, you could apply for amnesty. I said it. And but they actually did a really good job. And I would say now it'd probably be a lot easier because the agency is separated. You know,
people are willing to take the risk of filing an application versus the risk of being caught. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just the bottom line is that they did a very good job in 1986, and I don't see this as being any different.
There's been a lot of thought given to the problem because, as you say, it has been a problem. But next question here.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. My name is Tang Vu, and I'm an immigrant rights advocate with the Arizona Dream Act Coalition. And I've been reading lately articles about Mr. Bill Montgomery, about your manners in prosecuting undocumented workers. So what I'm basically asking is an answer directly from you is, if a citizen who is underage was buying alcohol, and let's say another undocumented worker who is working to support her family with false identification as well, but that identification may not belong to anyone because the social security number doesn't exist, is there a difference between how those two would be charged?
Yes.
And how?
By law. And I would caution you not to believe everything you read in the first place. Secondly, under Arizona law, you cannot charge someone who commits a violation of our liquor laws by using false identification to purchase alcohol with an identity theft offense. Secondly, you asked a question, I'm going to answer it. Secondly, when you have someone who's using somebody else's information and it's a false assumption that that information doesn't belong to someone, in investigations where there is a no match between a name and a number, the Social Security Administration will not tell us who it actually belongs to. Those two crimes are very different, and the Arizona legislature exercised the policy choice and has directed executive branch officers, of which I am one, to treat those as two different offenses. Lastly, the first one that you mentioned is a misdemeanor offense that is handled by city prosecutors. So if you want them to handle them differently, go to the Arizona legislature or go to a city prosecutor.
We have about 4 minutes left. I'd like to get as many of our commentators as possible or questioners to step forward. So step forward quickly. If you'll be brief, we'll be brief, and we'll try to get two or three more in before we have to leave.
Hi, my name is Maria Castro. I'm a student here at Arizona State University. I'm also on the executive board of the Arizona Dream Act Coalition. And I would like to hear from the Republicans on the panel, how can you guys help us influence Governor Brewer to let the Dreamers drive? Because all this talk of comprehensive immigration reform, how can we be comprehensive here in the state of Arizona to give these documented deferred action eligible students the opportunity to drive? Because this is something that's very prominent, and we're one of two states that doesn't allow our Dreamers to drive.
Well, I'm going to suggest that since that's a little bit off topic, you've presented a practical problem that is inherent in the failure to solve this problem overall, and it's just another illustration of, at least to me, a reason to try to resolve the problem at a national level. But there certainly will be local issues that are created too. I'm not going to ask people to identify their political party or tell you how to lobby the governor. I'm not sure I could do that myself. So.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Jose Peñalosa. I'm an immigration attorney here in Arizona for 23 years. Just a comment about the bill. I think it's an excellent bill. I read it, and it is the art of compromise. And there is items both for both parties. I will tell you the good parts about this. It'll clear the dockets in the immigration court. We have a 6-year wait in court. Number two, it's going to give people the right to work, travel. It's going to clear private detention centers that are holding people and their families detained. It's going to lessen prosecutions here in Maricopa County, allow Mr. Montgomery to concentrate on the real crime. So those are the positive aspects that I see. In addition to that, it's going to allow for citizenship. Folks that are 55 years and older that don't know English are going to be able to become citizens. And the fact that we have to remember here, a lot of the people here that are going to immigrate are not just from Mexico. It's a worldwide immigration. So people come from Mexico, yes, they do, unlawfully, because they use it as a transit country. Most important here is that it's going to give an opportunity to raise up the economy here in the United States. People are already talking to me about buying homes, financing education, buying cars, and traveling. This is a great bill. We should advocate for it and get it passed this year. Thank you.
Appreciate the point of view. We have time probably for about one more. Yes, ma'am. Please step forward.
Mm-hmm. I'm Priscilla Gibson, and I grew up in South America, so I have a different perspective. The issue I see is that illegal immigrants come from everywhere. How are you handling this? Because I think a lot of Arizonans are focusing about people who come from Mexico, Guatemala, El Salvador, etc. And we have people from Africa. We have the continent of Africa, by the way. From the continent of Asia, the hugest one we have. And they all have issues. So how is this legislation going to work for in everyone's case?
Well, it doesn't matter whether you have authority, whether you don't have permission from any country to be eligible for the same type of relief. So if you're here on an authorized basis, no matter what country you're from, you can apply.
And we're going to leave it at that. We're getting the signal that it's time to cut the conversation off. I hope that as a result of the knowledge of the panelists and their experience that you've both gotten an idea of what this legislation that's at least been introduced proposes to do, some of the problems in moving forward, but perhaps some ideas about how to improve it as well. Let me express on behalf of Arizona State University my appreciation for the way that you, the audience, has conducted yourself today. You've been a real great audience, and I hope that together we can continue this conversation. And if the past is prologue here, this group right here could make a difference in seeing that the legislation that will benefit our country can eventually be adopted. Thank you all very much. Thank you to Arizona State University. Thank you, panelists.